Okay. Good afternoon, everyone. No mic. Thank you. I think I can project, but I'm not sure I can project to the World Wide Web without a mic, so we'll hope that comes back in. Good morning, everyone, and welcome back to the Peterson Institute for International Economics. Obviously, we have a very full house today, as I think befits both the topic and the work that we're offering, an assessment of the Trans-Pacific Partnership focused on the market access and the sectoral issues. Obviously, many of you know and expect the Peterson Institute to be an advocate for freer trade in the world and for U.S. leadership on trade, and we are. But I think and I hope you all recognize that we try to do so with full intellectual honesty, disclosure, and not blindness to the impacts of trade. And we tried to do that very fairly throughout our discussions of TPP. This has been a major project of the Institute over the last several months, led by Jeffrey Schott and Kathleen Cimino Isaacs, who've done a great job of marshaling both resident and non-resident scholars. And we've tried to be as applicable and accessible, but also as open as we can be. I think there's much to be said, obviously, about the politics of TPP. We can get into that in the discussion, and I'm sure we will have many opportunities to talk about that in the coming months. There's also much to be said about the foreign policy aspects of TPP. These are critical, and these are not easily mastered. The balancing act of what, at least as economists here at the Peterson Institute, we hope is open regionalism in TPP, with the formulation that some make that TPP is a strategic move against China or something like that, is something that concerns us. But today, we at least initially would like to focus on the work and the analysis at a straight economics level of the TPP as now publicly available, what it actually means for the people of the U.S., the people of the other signatory powers, participating countries, and potentially for other countries out there who are affected, as well as talking about the sectoral and distributional aspects at a first but pretty rigorous cut. We're going to have presentations today on multiple aspects of our new briefing, which has been published and released today. Contains several chapters on different parts of the TPP. Jeff Schott, who's the co-editor of this, will take you through some of those. We will have highlight presentations by Jeff, who's led numerous studies for the Institute on trade policy, economic integration in Americas and Asia, and of course was a leading intellectual light behind the Korea-U.S. Free Trade Agreement. We will then have some remarks by Carolyn Freund. Dr. Freund has now been a senior fellow with us for nearly 2 years. No, going on 3 years, I'm delighted to say. And she's, like so many of our fellows, is doing double duty. Today she's here with her trade hat on, talking about some of the issues of tariff reduction, and particularly the auto sector, where she's done outstanding work. But next week we will be releasing her new book on various forms of capitalism, export competitiveness and growth in emerging markets, rich people, poor countries, and we're looking forward to that as well. We'll be followed by a, I'd like to think, close member of the PIE family, Kimberly Ann Elliott, who is now a senior fellow, of course, at the Center for Global Development. She'd previously been a fellow here at the Peterson Institute. She's currently a member of the National Advisory Committee for Labor Provisions and U.S. Free Trade Agreements, has served in various consultative roles, and she'll be talking about some of the textile agriculture and developing economy issues and how that competes with the U.S. And then finally, the man who makes everything run at the Peterson Institute, or rather everything that I don't have to do, thank God, is Gary Huffbauer, the Reginald Jones Senior Fellow here at the Institute. Gary, as all of you know, I hope, has a unique position as someone who knows cold both the economics and the legal aspects, and he will be taking us through some of the particularly politically thorny aspects of the TPP. What really is in ISDS, and does it matter? If I could just make two additional remarks. Last week, we published to quite a bit of attention, I think deservedly so, the latest CGE modeling of the impact of the TPP by Professors Peter Petrie and Michael Plummer. There is room for discussion about whether such models truly capture everything. They certainly do not. But there is a huge professional consensus, including among people who are not terribly necessarily pro-trade deals, that the methods that Peter and Michael used are pretty close to state-of-the-art and represent the reality when you're trying to balance some sort of quantitative estimates with some sort of analytical rigor. You have to make some choices about what to include and what not to include. And there is another study out there, which I will not deign to name, that has attempted to argue that their approach is an acceptable alternative. As for those of you who follow this on the web and Twitter will find, there is a vast range of professional opinion that suggests at least that other approach is incorrect. And so I commend to all of you the detailed discussions of methodology, including a recent blog post by Robert Lawrence of the Kennedy School and the Peterson Institute, explaining why Petrie and Plummer took the choice they did. Now, I know you were all here spellbound to hear me talk about methodology. So I will leave it there unless we come back to it. Obviously, we're happy to talk about it, but I do want to make three additional points because the Petrie-Plummer model gives us a baseline to talk about what are some of the adjustments that are involved in TPP, as well as the best available estimates realistically of what are the gains. The first point I just want to make is, like all serious Peterson Institute studies, we have made the data and the computations available on our website. So people who don't want to just cast stones but wish to run serious critiques of the paper or any of our analyses are welcome to do so, and I encourage you to take the data and run with it. The second point, more importantly, is just to get across what we're talking about today. We're talking about growth. We're talking about productivity. We're talking about changes in the relative position of various industries and various markets in different countries. We're talking about, in other words, the core of economic integration. That is not primarily a story about jobs one way or the other. No matter how many times people on Capitol Hill or how many times people in the press would like to make it about that, that's just not right. Because ultimately, and you can see this in the history of the US for the last 150 years, trade deals come, trade deals go. The number of participants in the workforce that we have and the way they are employed fundamentally reflect demographics, reflect productivity trends, reflect education. We have a much higher rate of employment participation now, even at the drop, than we did, say, in the 70s or 80s before trade deals. And so while some people have occasionally said so many jobs are going to be lost or gained by a given trade deal, that's not our point here today. And it's not because we're ducking the question. It's because those estimates are frankly misleading and unfounded. And if you look carefully at the Petrie and Plummer study or any other serious CGE analysis, what they tell you is the relative growth rate of employment in various sectors may change. And clearly, trade with the emerging world means the relative growth rate of employment in manufacturing in the rich world goes down versus the relative employment growth rate of services. That is not a death sentence, and in fact, that is a huge gain of economic efficiency. But we have to be realistic, as the Institute, I think, has always been, about the adjustment costs for those people involved, which leads to my third and final point. Recently, last week, a non-Peterson Institute study, there are such things, got deserved attention. It's a paper by Autor, Hans Dorn, and Hansen on the impact of Chinese manufacturers on jobs in the US. Gordon Hansen has long been a member of the Institute's Academic Advisory Committee, has published with us, and we have many of his former students at various times as research analysts and fellows even. And we have high respect for all of these authors, and I commend all of you to read the study. And what the study says, as Gordon made clear in the New York Times, and as Jared Bernstein also commented in the New York Times made clear, it says that the U.S. economy is fundamentally letting down its workers. It's fundamentally letting them down and helping them retrain. It's fundamentally letting them down when specific local communities get hit by job change. It's fundamentally letting them down on sharing the benefits from not just trade, but economic growth more broadly that go to the top part of the income distribution. And I don't think anyone at the Peterson Institute seeks to be callous about that. And I know that I, for one, have been on the record many times with my macroeconomics hat on, saying that American business and American government need to do more to help the adjustment and the employment of American workers. What is important, even though you've heard it before, is to understand that the gains from TPP, even though people would like to characterize them as small sometimes, are sufficient in the hundreds of billions of dollars per year, that there is enough money there that we should be able to help the people who need to adjust as a result of trade. And that is the preferred alternative to passing on trade deals that give hope for people in emerging Asia and Latin America to come out of poverty and be free in a market-based world. With that light thought in mind, let me turn it over to Jeff, who can really talk about the substance. Jeff.
Well, thank you, Adam. Adam has given me the task of covering 6,000 pages of trade agreement text in 10 minutes. So excuse me if I forget or leave out one or two points that may seem critical, but I'll do my best. Essentially, the TPP is a big deal, and it's important to know what's in it and what it means for TPP countries. It is the largest FTA, free trade agreement, among involving both developed and developing countries in terms of both the scope of coverage and the depth of its liberalization. It is more than just a small increment to our stable of free trade agreements. One needs to look at the TPP as an FTA upgrader. I mean, all FTAs are upgraded by the TPP. So it goes well beyond what has been in previous agreements, and that addition, that upgrading of the existing PACs is really an important component of the benefits that accrue from the agreement. As Adam said, the gains are large in terms of real income. If anything, these types of modeling exercises usually underestimate the potential gains. That's certainly been true in past agreements. The deal is not perfect. It reflects political reality and the need to secure the requisite support in legislatures around in all the TPP countries. And it means that when the final deal was put together, it had to be recalibrated to try to maximize that political support. In some areas, it meant adding to the liberalization. In some areas, it meant paring back a little bit in the liberalization commitments. That was part of the final deal. And the last general point is to note that the TPP is a living agreement and has an open door for future membership once the agreement enters into force. Now, what we have presented today is really the first volume of studies, and it's quite extensive, covering goods, services, and investment. We have another volume that will be released in a couple of weeks, another opportunity for another good meal. And a lot of the important issues that people are concerned about are also in that second volume, so stay tuned for more important analysis on intellectual property and the like. Now, in terms of the gains reported by Petrie and Plummer, a simple way of looking at it is this sort of summary chart that I put together. And there are a couple of points worth emphasizing. One is that the overall gains in terms of permanent real income gains are quite significant, almost $500 billion in permanent real income gains, an increase over baseline of over 1%. The United States and Japan account for about 55% of the absolute gains, which is understandable, the two largest economies. But also notable is that two of the poorer countries, Vietnam and Malaysia, in relative terms, get the biggest gains in terms of boost to their real incomes in the order of 7.5% to 8%. That's also very important, and one of the reasons why those countries that are making the biggest changes to their existing policies have been avid supporters of committing to the high standard TPP obligations. Also interesting is the point that if you look at total non-member TPP, the impact on non-TPP countries, it's small, but it's positive. So no net diversion or no net losses, income losses for those countries, though of course that differs among countries. And indeed, there is one country in there, China, that has modest, very modest income losses from the TPP-12. I should note that if you have an expansion of TPP members that include additional large countries in Asia, that number could grow substantially. So that is something that I know Chinese officials are looking at very carefully. So this slide basically summarizes those key points that I just made, and notes in addition that for in terms of what types of reforms are important, non-tariff reforms, the non-tariff barriers that so plague traders in the Asia Pacific and around the world, are more important than the tariff cuts, though don't discount the importance of the tariff cuts, as you'll hear shortly. And liberalization of NTBs on goods and services make the biggest contribution to U.S. growth. This is a similar summary table on export gains from the TPP. Again, huge gains overall for the TPP 12 countries, over $1 trillion of additional exports, up over 11.5% once the agreement is fully implemented. And the United States and Japan account for a little over 60% of these aggregate gains. But also interesting in this table is to look at the bottom and to see that there are some cases where countries will suffer some losses. Korea, Thailand, and Indonesia are just a few. Interestingly, all of those countries are interested in joining and doing extensive analysis now of the TPP to decide whether to ask to join in the future. For the U.S. gains, they are across all sectors in the economy. These are just the export gains. But they in all areas, the U.S. export gains are higher than they would be in the absence of TPP. Now, highlights and lowlights. And some of these points will be amplified by my colleagues. First point to make is on tariffs. The majority of tariffs are eliminated very quickly across all the 12 countries. There are some notable exceptions. U.S. tariffs on autos and SUVs, thank you, Wendy, are subject to such a long delay that these products are effectively exempted from liberalization from a commercial perspective. If you have 25, 30 years, it's just not a relevant phase-out period for any business, and so they're effectively exempted. Agriculture. Also substantial cuts in farm protection, even for sensitive Japanese products. Thank you, Wendy. That offsets what you did on autos.
Don't be so ad hominem.
Yeah. I should note that Wendy Cutler is with us and has been one of the most distinguished U.S. trade negotiators and one of the key contributors to putting this deal together. And so we all thank you very much, Wendy, for your service and your contribution. Now, in agriculture, there are substantial cuts, little change in U.S. sugar and dairy policy, which make many people on Capitol Hill very happy. Could the results have been better? And the results are very, very good. I think most agricultural groups in the United States have applauded the deal. The deal probably could have been a little better in some sectors, but you reap what you sow. And the U.S. position on sugar and dairy allowed other countries to emulate U.S. Example to some extent. So we got a very, very good deal, but we left a little bit on the table because of the political demands that we hold tight on our sugar and dairy program. On autos and textiles, overall, the TPP helps U.S. exporters, and there are limited gains for TPP exporters to the United States. The TPP revises the NAFTA rules of origin on autos and parts, probably more significant on the parts side than the auto side, given the low level of U.S. MFN tariffs on autos. And it largely maintains the restrictive yarn forward rule in textiles and apparel from current practice. Kim Elliott will talk more about that in a moment. In government procurement, the agreement is the first major opening for Vietnam and Malaysia, and so that's a very big step forward for exporters to those countries and for those two countries themselves because of the added efficiencies in the procurement process. There is, unfortunately, limited coverage of sub-federal contracts, so this is just at the federal level to a large extent. On services, the United States gains improved access to the markets of Japan, Malaysia, and Vietnam, very important for insurance, express air delivery. Sticky U.S. barriers, like the Jones Act, remain stuck in place. As in agriculture, the overall result suffered a bit because other countries reduced their offers in response to the U.S. insistence in maintaining its longstanding restrictions in maritime and elsewhere. But overall, still a very good result. And it could have been a little better, but we're not in the game of putting together perfect trade agreements. We're put in the business of putting together agreements that have substantial benefits for the overall country. Financial services deserves a mention, though. There is greater access for portfolio management and payment and clearing services, and some constraints on state-run postal insurance systems. This is all good news for the world-class U.S. firms in these sectors. But the agreement permits data localization requirements, and along with broad prudential safeguards, this suggests that the gains in this sector will be narrowly focused. Investment, another important step forward in the TPP. The TPP reduces barriers to FDI in many, many sectors, deploying a negative list approach, which essentially makes it much harder to exclude sectors from the coverage of the trade disciplines. It includes new disciplines on the use of local content requirements that have been a bane on traders and investors in throughout the world, particularly since the financial crisis 7 years ago. Gary Huffbauer and I and Kathleen Cimino have written extensively about that in a book here at the Institute, and we're glad that the new disciplines are beginning to be introduced in trade agreements, starting with the TPP. There are new limits on state-owned enterprises and improved investor-state dispute settlement procedures that Gary Huffbauer will talk about in a moment. So I've expended my time period. The last point to make is that the TPP is a living agreement and is open to new members. A number of countries already jockeying for position in a new tranche of negotiation, membership tranche of negotiations. Korea, Indonesia, Thailand, Taiwan, the Philippines, Colombia, maybe a few others. They are all doing intensive studies of what the TPP means for them and what the challenges and opportunities of membership would be. TPP expansion would amplify the prospective net gains from TPP. How TPP expansion evolves will turn importantly on what happens in terms of ratification in the United States, whether Indonesia follows through on new commitments to reform and join TPP going forward, because that would have a big implication for Southeast Asia and for the other major countries in Northeast Asia, and whether China wants to join, and if so, when. That's a big question, too big to cover in my 10-minute presentation, which is now up. Thank you very much.
I want to start by actually thanking some other people who helped work on the TPP study so that we could get it out so quickly after the agreement was posted online. So really big thanks go to Sarah Oliver and Tyler Moran. They painstakingly codified the tariff elimination schedules. And I'm going to show you what that means in this presentation. That assisted both with this chapter and also with the work that Peter Petrie and Plummer did. So really big thanks. Sarah also wrote the auto chapter and both contributed extensively to the briefs coming online. So I'm actually going to talk about the most traditional component of a trade agreement, tariff reduction or tariff elimination. And so this is about goods trade, not about the broader services where many of the gains are coming from. So just to reiterate some of the points that Jeff made, and I'll go through this quickly since he already went over it. The agreement is a big agreement. This is 40% of world GDP. U.S. gains over $100 billion, total gains nearly half a trillion. But tariffs account for only about 10% of this gain. So most of the gain, because the big countries, US and Japan, already have low tariffs, most of the gain is coming from reforms on the services side, regulations, things like that, and not actually from the tariff reduction. That said, tariff reduction is still very important for some sectors and for some countries. So I want to say something about the tariff elimination schedules, because if you go into the USTR website and you pull up a schedule, what you're going to see is something like the bottom of this chart. And there's some peculiarities with tariff elimination schedules, which I just want to draw your attention to. And one is they're very specific. We're talking about over 10,000 products that we have tariffs on. Tariff schedules in and of themselves are endogenous and political to some extent. You can tell just by how many categories a product has or a sector, subsector has, how sensitive it is. So there's as many lines of tomatoes as there is of passenger cars, yet one is much more important for trade than the other. So we have 8 lines of each. But the most peculiar feature of the TPP, in my view, is that it allows for specific tariffs to individual partners and specific elimination schedules. So you'll see these are the vehicles parts, but what you see is that there's a different phase out in some cases for Japan versus the rest. So that there's differentiation among partners, which kind of goes against what we think of when we think of Article 24, that we want as much as possible to have a uniform system across countries. So I just want to make this point that there is this differentiation in the TPP. It allows for more liberalization because political realities can be addressed as a result, but there's some opaqueness there where you have to look up a code to figure out what it means from another document and such. As I said, the sectors in a tariff schedule just themselves are somewhat political. So I did a little word cloud of all the products, so those 10,000 products. And what you can see is the products that are listed many times are the apparel and the agriculture. So just for example, the word knitted appears more than 500 times in the 10,000 plus tariff categories. So some sectors are more sensitive than others, and we can see that just from looking at an actual tariff schedule. When we compare U.S. tariffs to the TPP average, and this is a little bit unfair because the TPP average is going to average across a lot of countries, some of which, like Singapore, have zero tariffs. So that's going to pull down any, you know, idiosyncratic high tariffs in the TPP average. But just to give you an idea again of where tariffs are high, so U.S. tariffs on average are higher than the TPP average on textiles and oil seeds. Everyone, so the upper right quadrant is where everyone's tariffs are high, tend to be apparel, footwear, dairy, sugar, some agricultural products. And then our trade partners tend to have higher tariffs, mainly on some ag products, as well as stone, glass, and furniture. As Jeff said, turning from sectors to countries, that Japan and the U.S. have the biggest aggregate gains. And for Japan, actually, a pretty significant share, about 30% of the gains in income to Japan are actually coming from tariff reduction. For Vietnam, also substantial. And interestingly, a big part of the loss to China vis-a-vis trade diversion is also coming via the tariff reduction within TPP. China exports a lot of cars and other goods, especially to Malaysia, Vietnam, et cetera. And now those countries with very high tariffs will have lower tariffs for the TPP countries. From the U.S. perspective, U.S. tends to have lower tariffs versus all its trade partners. So there'll be more of a gain for the export sector in the U.S. as compared with exports from other countries to the U.S. or U.S. imports, which already face pretty low tariffs. So this weights tariffs by total exports in a category. The reason to do that is if you weight by imports, you're going to have really small weights on high tariffs. So how important is that tariff on a product that's really important to you? And what you see is that given base rates, there's a potential for really large tariff reduction to U.S. exports in Malaysia and Vietnam, but much less so for these countries to the U.S. because the U.S. tariff schedule is already a lot more liberalized. The next topic I want to turn to is the speed of liberalization. And while I agree with Jeff that there's a rabbit in there and that a lot's done right away, there's also a turtle sneaking in parts of the agreement. So we end up really with three kind of groups. And the first are the rabbits, Australia, Chile, New Zealand, and Singapore, which are already pretty open economies. And they jump in and liberalize right away. By year 8, all their tariffs are gone. Canada, Japan, and US, which are pretty open economies, but with some sensitive sectors, are quite a bit slower. So what we see is that they're kind of turbots. They're rabbits on some parts of liberalization. They get rid of a lot of tariffs right away, but then they're turtles on those sensitive sectors. So there's a few laggards out there. And then finally, we have our slow but steady turtles down there, the Malaysia, Mexico, Peru, and Vietnam, that take all their tariffs are gone in year 16, and they sort of gradually, slow but steady, win the race, at least with the U.S., which goes until year 30. But the quick is that 75% of tariff lines are liberalized immediately, and 99% are liberalized by the end of this agreement. So it is a full trade liberalization agreement, but what it's not is a super quick one. So I just want you to think that in Article 24, which is about regional trade agreements, they never put in a time limit on how fast liberalization had to be, and the wording is a reasonable length of time. And in the past, that was interpreted as a decade. So for NAFTA, for Canada-US, it was kind of a decade. For NAFTA, almost all was done in a decade. The WTO rounds have actually typically even been quicker, 5 to 8 years. So I think there is a concern within the WTO, so one of the lowlights of moving to really slow liberalization that's highly differentiated across partners. So one thing I would have liked to have seen is a little less of that. However, there is a lot of liberalization in this agreement, and that balanced some of the political constraints. Here's just a visual of it. So you can see the quickness, years for the agreement to come into force is on the horizontal axis and the tariff rates on the vertical axis. Tariffs are coming down. A lot of that liberalization, the highest density, is really in right near the origin, that coming down quickly. But there is this kind of laggard thing of taking a really, really long time on some products. One way of thinking of the TPP is as a U.S.-Japan free trade agreement. These are the two big guys in the agreement, and it's where the bulk of the aggregate gains come from. So if we want to kind of focus in on what's happening with U.S. and Japan, what we can see, look at is their base rates. So what is their actual, what's the kind of texture of their trade policy at present? What we see is that both are relatively open with, you know, around 40% of products completely free. And this is actually at the six-digit level using about 5,000 products. Then where U.S. has relatively low tariffs, but it does have a lot of these specific tariffs on things like agriculture. So instead of ad valorem tariffs, things like cents per kilo, which can be more distortionary to trade, or tariff rate quotas, Japan tends to be a little bit less heavy on those kind of specific tariffs, but has a higher, still small, share of 20-plus tariffs above 20%. So just to kind of show you what their current situation looks like. And how does liberalization between these two large economies happen? Well, a lot of it, the dark blue is by industry, the zero base rate. So you can see there's very low zero in textiles and also somewhat in the animal products in Japan. A lot of tariffs are eliminated immediately, so that's the rabbit part. Then we have this very slow kind of liberalization in the U.S. of the sensitive sectors, with most of it done. In Japan, it's a little bit quicker, but they exclude some of the agricultural products from the agreement altogether. So that's what you see, those two kind of bright yellow bars or sections of the bar where they have excluded actually some products. That's of somewhat concern because The products that are excluded are probably the most sensitive, but they're probably also the products where the biggest gain would actually come were they to liberalize those products. So that's sort of how it balances out. And finally, just a couple words on the transport sector. And some of this applies beyond cars and trucks, also to things like tractors and so forth. If we look at the tariff rates, this is, again, years to expire in current tariff rates. The U.S. has taken a long time, but on cars, the tariff is very low, 2.5%. It's on trucks that it's high at the 25% that's gonna sit there till year 30. But the countries really with the very high tariffs on cars and trucks are Vietnam and Malaysia. So there's a really big gain to be had there because these guys aren't liberalizing immediately. But unlike the U.S., where the tariffs hang out and then drop off a cliff, these guys are liberalizing over time. And so this openness to really big auto producers like U.S. and Japan is a big deal. Vietnam and Malaysia are also liberalizing within ASEAN, and cars and trucks will be liberalized completely, I believe, by 2018. So this will also put everyone kind of more on a level playing field within that and limit the amount of trade diversion that otherwise might happen by not including some of the big auto producers. So the story isn't just U.S. There's a real gain here from liberalization of the auto sector in Vietnam and Malaysia, both of whom have been kind of protecting their own countries in order to develop that sector. There's a little picture of an auto plant in Vietnam. And this is my last slide before I conclude. Just a word on rules of origin. So a big change is in the rules of origin. Initially, these will impact things like engines before actual vehicles because of the U.S. tariff remaining in place. But we had 62.5% of local content in the NAFTA. That will now shift to 45% TPP content. So this is, you know, from one side, 45 is still a pretty high number, but from the other side, 20 percentage points is a really big jump. So this can allow, over time, for a pretty big redrawing of the industry over the long run. And, you know, just to give you an idea, the best-selling car in the U.S. is the Toyota Camry. I think around there's many people from the auto industry here, so I think someone can correct me, but I think it's around 500,000 a year, something like that. The Toyota Camry is 75% local content, so it easily meets that NAFTA criteria right now. But because it's so big, even though the tariff is small, there is a significant savings there. So you can imagine over time, and especially with parts changing, there may be a bit of reorientation of production in a more efficient structure via the TPP. So finally, just to conclude, tariff liberalization isn't the biggest part of TPP, but it is especially important for some countries and some sectors. It's very deep, but there's a bit of a trade-off between speed and depth. So in some cases, it takes quite a long time. And my biggest concern about it is this differentiation across countries and the delays that I think could set a dangerous precedent in the WTO if we start to see a lot of agreements like this, because then what we really have is a world where tariffs are bilateral, not multilateral, and that will be a lot less transparent. And I'll conclude there. Thank you. Thank you.
Well, I want to thank Adam and Jeff for including me, and thank Kathleen for helping to coordinate all of the outside and other authors, Kathleen Cimino Isaacs, and both Kathleen and Steve Wiseman also read the chapter and gave me comments, so I appreciate that. I want to give them thanks. I am mainly going to focus on the textile issues and rules of origin that I wrote about for the volume, but let me just start with a couple of broader comments on sort of implications for developing countries from this mega-regional trend broadly. And I think, you know, one of the things that is sort of striking about both Jeff and Caroline's presentations is, you know, these so-called 21st century gold standards agreements still are having trouble with the old issues. You know, ag is still getting treated specially. We're still going to have quantitative restrictions, and some of the sensitive sector barriers are never going away. So, you know, that's sort of a different. The trade remedies chapter, are the old, you know, anti-dumping and countervailing duties, it's, you know, there's a little bit of process stuff, but no new obligations there. You know, the intellectual property, you know, we're going overboard. You know, intellectual property is supposed to be about a balance between innovation and dissemination, and it's the dissemination where the social benefits come from. And these are pushing, you know, even from a U.S. perspective, we're perhaps overgoing in terms of the innovation. So there are sort of concerns in terms of what's in and what's left out for developing countries that are both in, and the vast majority of developing countries that are outside these agreements. But of course, the real problem for the majority that are outside is, what is this doing to the multilateral trade system? And I recognize that after Nairobi, there are many problems at the WTO, and the mega regionals are not the main thing. But there is still, there's the hope that there'll be a building block towards multilateralizing a lot of this stuff. But I think that's still very much subject to question, and the concern is that they could be more of a stumbling block, which for, again, the majority of developing countries that are outside is potentially a really big problem. But the chapter I actually did was focusing on the textile trade and the TPP rules of origin. And here, again, in the manufacturing sector, you know, mostly, at least in the context of U.S. and Japan, all of the tariffs do eventually get eliminated, sometimes after a very long time. But that doesn't necessarily mean that the markets are really free and open. And in those sectors, what we see is rules of origin being used to continue to manage the trade even after tariffs are reduced or eliminated. Now, any preferential agreement, you have to have rules of origin, because you don't want a third party just shipping stuff through a party country and on to the destination in order to take advantage of the tariff reduction. But quite often in the sensitive sectors, the rules of origin are manipulated to dampen the effect of the tariff reductions. You've got a wide range of types of rules, and I'm not going to go into all the detail on this. But in the case of U.S. textiles, going back to the NAFTA agreement, the U.S. has used what's called a yarn-forward rule of origin. And what that means is that everything from the yarn has to be spun in the region, and the fabric woven, and the final garment assembled, all from inputs within the region, or if it's a bilateral deal, just between the two parties to the agreement. So that means that no third-party fabric, in theory, I mean, if that's the base rule, if that were applied across the board, no third-party inputs could be used in assembling apparel that's going to get a benefit from the TPP rule of origin. So this is primarily, in the context of TPP, a U.S.-Vietnam story. Vietnam is the poorest party to the TPP. Apparel is a very important export for Vietnam. Most of its apparel exports go to the U.S., and most of U.S. imports from TPP parties, over 60%, are from Vietnam. So this is primarily a bilateral story, and it's a particularly, in theory, a very important potential benefit. I don't know if you can see that very well, but this is average tariffs on the tall bar is for textiles and apparel. So well above the overall average. The next one is, I think, footwear and travel goods, and then everything else, you know, barely above zero. And that's including, for this purpose, MFN zero duties. So you know, this is outside of ag, and especially for Vietnam, textiles and apparel is where the big gains could be because that's where the big tariffs are. But we have the rule of origin. In terms of what's going to happen to textile and apparel trade, most of the U.S. tariffs are reduced immediately by either a third to a half, depending on the product, and then the remainder of the tariff stays in place for 10 to 12 years. Some are duty-free upon entry, but those tend not to be the things that Vietnam is exporting. The things that it's mostly exporting tend to be the ones that are subject to only a third reduction immediately, and then, and not a phase out. The two-thirds of the rest of the tariff stays in place all the way to the very, very end of the period. In the case of Canada and Japan, they're actually eliminating most of their textile and apparel, and they're the second, the next two largest markets for Vietnamese apparel, and they're going to eliminate most of their apparel tariffs immediately upon entry into force. But those Vietnamese exports are still going to be subject to that, to the yarn forward rule of origin. And why is that a problem? Well, most of, not all, but a good chunk of Vietnam's imports of fabric and other apparel inputs are from China, another pretty big chunk from Korea, and then another, not shown in the chart, but a fairly big chunk from Taiwan. Only about 7.5% of Vietnamese inputs for apparel are from the currently from within the TPP region. So what that means is it's going to have higher costs trying to source its inputs or will not be able to take advantage of the tariff. So that really seriously diminishes the potential benefits for Vietnam. Now, there are some flexibilities. That's not, and almost always because the yarn forward, if it were implemented completely, would wipe out the, it would be too costly to meet and wipe out the tariff benefit. So there's always usually some form of flexibility. Excuse me. A couple of products, synthetic baby clothes and brassieres, will be subject to what's called single transformation, meaning they can use inputs from outside the region and be assembled in Vietnam and still benefit. There's a short supply list, which does include cotton fabric for men's dress shirts, which is, it's about $250 million currently of Vietnamese exports. So out of a total of about $9 billion of Vietnamese exports for apparel. So that'll have some benefit, but again, not huge. And then there's this very complicated earned import allowance, where if Vietnam imports fabric for cotton pants, men's or women's, certain kinds of cotton pants, including jeans and khakis, for each unit of fabric imported from the U.S., then they'll be allowed to ship a pair of pants using fabric from elsewhere. And it's a fairly complicated formula. But again, the point being that's going to be a probably pretty limited utility if you think about shipping, denim all the way from the U.S. across the Pacific, assembling it into jeans in Vietnam, and then shipping it back. Is that going to be, profitable with only a third cut in the tariff? Seems questionable. And finally, in Central America, Mexico, and some of our other agreements with developing countries, there have been what are called tariff preference limits, which are in essence quotas, a certain amount of certain kinds of products that the country is allowed to ship using third-party inputs. We don't have that in the TPP at all. So it's a fairly limited flexibility under the yarn forward rule in this particular case. And so ultimately, Vietnam's only going to be able to really benefit, especially in the short run with the more limited tariff cuts, under two situations. One, which Jeff talked about, and we may see before too long, is if Korea, Taiwan, obviously there are political problems, but if they join, they have been important suppliers to Vietnam, and so that would help Vietnam to meet the rule of origin. The second possibility is that Vietnam, costs are going up in China already. Some of that lower end apparel sector investment is looking to go elsewhere, so some of that could go to Vietnam. Vietnam might be able to develop those upstream textile sectors and then be able to meet the rule and get the tariff benefit. But again, keep in mind that for the first 10 to 12 years, it's only a third to a half of a reduction in tariff. So is that going to be enough of an incentive to track the investment, I think, is still a question mark. So let me just finally conclude again, going back to what about some other developing countries. To the degree that Vietnam is able to benefit, it's potentially at the, or probably is, will be to some degree at the expense of some other very poor countries in the region, and Bangladesh and Cambodia in particular, which are UN-designated least developed countries. They compete in many of these same apparel sectors. Every other rich country in the world, including Japan, Australia, New Zealand, the other TPP high-income countries, already provide duty-free, quota-free market access for most or all products for these least developed countries. The U.S. is alone among the high-income countries in not doing that. We provide pretty good access for Africa under the Africa Growth and Opportunity Act, but the Asia and for Haiti under the various Haiti Special Preference Acts, but nothing for the LDCs in Asia. So I think it's really, this is the time where, as part of the TPP implementation, the U.S. really should move on duty-free, quota-free to mitigate the potential for that injury to some very poor countries. Thank you.
Well, the bad news is you're going to be tested on all these PowerPoints. And the good news is I don't have any PowerPoints. So I'm going to talk quickly about two subjects. One is services, and the other is investor-state dispute settlement. But before I launch into this, I really want to say it's always a pleasure to come to these meetings on trade, because I see so many of our old friends and colleagues in the think tank world, in the business world. But I especially want to call out those who have served with great dignity and spirit in the past on trade agreements of yesteryear: Alan Wolf, Peter Allgeier, Michael Gadbaugh, Sean Donnelly, and there are many others. But these people have devoted a good part of their lives to the precursors to what we have today, and provided the platform for Wendy Cutler and her colleagues. I also want to call out Kathleen Cimino, who really put together this volume. I mean, she's been working weekends and nights and whatever, and so what you see in the volume, which is much more than what we can cover here, Kathleen deserves an awful lot of credit. Well, turning to services, the ancient guild of mercantilism, which obviously includes some leading presidential candidates, would have you believe that if the TPP enables higher U.S. imports of textiles and auto parts and in furniture, it is a massive giveaway to those guys out there and is a big loss for the U.S. But the law of comparative advantage always has two sides. And the U.S. has enormous comparative advantage in services trade, just enormous. We're not talking haircuts, obviously. When I went to graduate school, which is a long, long time ago, I mean, they always said services, you know, can't be traded, and haircuts was in all the textbooks. But you know, you've got entertainment, education, health, finance, law, computer software. In fact, the TPP identifies 12 sectors and 168 subsectors of services which are tradable, and increasingly so with the internet, which I think is obvious. So let me just toss out a few statistics which show this U.S. comparative advantage. U.S. exports of cross-border services, which is just one component, in 2014 were $711 billion, and our imports were just $477 billion. I mean, that should make all the mercantilists just so happy, because, hey, 711 is greater than 477. In fact, the difference is about $239 billion. I mean, we have a big trade surplus in cross-border services. And the GDP gains through the delta in services trade on account of the TPP, when it's implemented, which is roughly 15 years out, will be about $54 billion, and that was out of Jeff's $131 billion in total gains. So it's a big fraction of the gains to our national income. Another way of looking at this comparative advantage story is that U.S. outward stock of services, foreign direct investment, is about $3.7 trillion. Again, I mean, you know, you've all heard the outsourcing story and all that. People picture some textile factory moving to Vietnam, I don't know what. But if you look at the foreign direct investment statistics, they are really loaded towards selling services abroad. $3.7 trillion out of, I think, our total FDI abroad is in the $5 trillion range. The inward stock of services, and, you know, it's a lot of different services, a lot of niches of comparative advantage, but it's only $1.2 trillion. Well, now, the TPP, as I mentioned, it's going to augment these services, both the flows of cross-border services and the stock of foreign direct investment in both directions, but it'll be more outward than inward. And why? Because the tariff equivalent barriers to services are just exceptionally high. Now, this estimation of tariff equivalent services is kind of a cottage trade in which the World Bank and the OECD specialize in a very good French institute, SAPI. And they kind of come up with the same results. We've compared them. Typically, and there are some numbers in the chapter, the typical range of tariff equivalent barriers is 30% to 70%. That compares with what Kim was just saying, 14% on U.S. textile imports. I mean, these are high barriers, and they're all regulatory barriers of one kind and another. Now, in 15 years, liberalizing these barriers abroad will deliver an additional $225 billion or so of U.S. exports to the TPP member countries. $225 billion. That's a big fraction of the total additional U.S. exports, which is, I think, something like 376. Jeff had the number up there. And the U.S. takes the lion's share of additional services exports, again, reflecting our comparative advantage. Now, I mean, I know that's all pretty, sounds pretty nerdy and jerky, but everybody in this room practically is participating in this comparative advantage of the services industry. So we have $149 billion out of the total increase in services trade in the whole TPP, which is more than 60%. Now, these are good jobs. I know, again, a metaphor for services trade, which some of the opponents like to sell, is hamburgers and McDonald's. That isn't it. I mean, you just look at the numbers, and Brad Jensen has done it. I don't think he's here today, but he's really done frontier work. And these are high-paying jobs, much higher than the average in the U.S. economy, much higher than manufacturing in the U.S. economy. Not to say we don't need the other jobs, but these are, on average, quite good jobs. There are four TPP chapters which are exclusively devoted to services because it's such a big deal. And that the negotiators are negotiators from Froman and all his colleagues deserve a lot of credit for putting so much emphasis on this, which is the frontier of trade expansion in the decades ahead, and really nailing down all these difficult areas and making a lot of progress on them. The negative list is the general approach, but of course there are a lot of exceptions. So here's a tip of the hat to the mercantilists who abound not in this room, but in this country. The U.S. hardly liberalized its services at all. You know, you can be so happy because we didn't do any liberalization to speak of. Now, the U.S. started off as being relatively open compared to other TPP countries, and you can look at the tariff equivalent numbers, but we didn't open much further. And as Jeff said, you know, what you sow is what you reap, and we have pretty strong restrictions in about four or five areas. Temporary entry of skilled personnel. Well, everyone here knows that story. Congress doesn't want it. Some of the presidential candidates don't want it. Our cabotage laws already been mentioned. It's not only the Jones Act, it's air transport. That's much bigger. We have very strong cabotage laws in air transport. State professional licenses, it's not only that states don't want to recognize, you know, qualified doctors from Japan. California doesn't want to recognize qualified doctors from my old state of New Mexico. Subfederal procurement is not liberalized, and there's a lot of service procurement. And those are the main ones, but foreign ownership of media is practically off limits. Now, so the U.S. could have gotten more if we'd been willing to give more, and the test of giving more will come with the TTIP agreement, the Transatlantic Trade and Investment Partnership, because Europe has said, I don't know whether these negotiations will go forward or not, but if they do, Europe has said it wants more on services, a lot more than what we gave the TPP partners. Now, quickly, how am I doing on time, Adam? Okay, 2 minutes. Investment State Dispute Settlement, ISDS. I should mention that Ted Moran and Lindsay Oldensky did a great chapter on investment generally. The chapter I'm talking about is just on investment state dispute settlement, investor state dispute settlement. And I guess every good show needs a devil. And for the opponents of TPP, this is the devil. So, but it's in the details. It's somewhat surprising this is the devil because similar provisions have been in agreements for more than 50 years, but suddenly it kind of leapt out of the grave, and here we have it. So why do we have ISDS? Well, for two reasons. Emerging countries want it as a seal of sign of good behavior with respect to foreign investors, and U.S. and U.S. companies want it because times change, as has happened in Bolivia, Venezuela, Argentina, and so forth, and they want some protection for companies when times change and the going gets rougher than it should be. Core principles are national treatment, MFN, fair and equitable. The TPP is quite different than its precursor, which you could say was NAFTA, at least for the U.S., in that it gives a lot of attention to the proper role for regulatory treatment, safety, health, safety, and environment. Let me just mention one statistic, and then I will stop because I've run out of time. There's about $25 trillion of foreign direct investment in the world at all, $25 trillion. The coverage of cases under ISDS is under probably, you know, $8 or $10 billion. I mean, it's a minuscule fraction of foreign direct investment which leads to any kind of litigation. And the amount of awards are in the hundreds of millions of dollars if you aggregated them all together. So it's not a big part of the overall FDI system, but it is an important part for the disciplinary role of trade agreements, just like criminal laws are an important part of our overall structure. Let me stop there.
Thank you so much, Gary, and all our speakers. I would like to invite up to the panel. We have such a full house of so many thoughtful people that we will almost immediately go to questions. Just let me add a couple points. I tried to say it, Jeff said it, Carolyn said it. We have an outstanding team of younger people, research analysts and research fellows at the Institute. Kathleen Cimino-Isaacs, who co-led this effort with Jeff, deserves special praise, but so indeed do Tyler Moran and Sarah Oliver, who really made the data happen. That's a great bridge to say two things that are important. I stressed earlier that the Petri Plummer paper, we have the data and calculations up on the website. This is part of our general commitment to transparency. But I would like you all to think about what's been presented today and the far more extensive document, which is available online for free for those who want it, is about public education, not indoctrination. Education. We've had several months, if not a couple of years, of dread of TPP in various quarters, that there were going to be secret codicils and dangerous things tucked into this, that, and the other piece of the agreement. I cannot promise you that President Obama did not do something somewhere, but we have now gone through the entire agreement in incredible detail. And our hope with this study today is to give a basis for public debate that if people want to talk about what's really in TPP, what's really the costs and benefits, what really is in the agreement, we're providing a basis for doing so. And that's, I think, in addition to all the rest that our staff, our team has done, that's the biggest contribution, that this becomes a basis for honest intellectual discussion and debate, not myth-making, not overgeneralization. Finally, one thing that did get mentioned, but I think bears returning to, is the idea of cost of delay. We're living in a world where growth is extremely hard to come by in the U.S., in the advanced economies, and now particularly in the emerging market economies. As Carolyn rightly pointed out, there is much lead time to get to full liberalization, and not everything is a rabbit. But the fact is, every year we put off even the start of liberalization is a missed opportunity. And it is a missed opportunity worth over $100 billion a year in income. And in a world where we're talking about raising tenths of a percent of growth rates in the major economies, given how low the average growth rates are, I think it is foolish for the Congress and for the legislatures around the world considering TPP not to take that into account when they decide how to think about this issue. Anyway, let me open up for questions. Our usual ground rules are, if you're seated towards the back, can I ask you to go to the standing mic, and I will, that includes you, sir, go to the standing mic back there and I will recognize you. If you're seated towards the front, Jessica will come to you with a mic. I ask that you identify yourself when speaking. This is all on the record. Given the nature of the discussion, you're welcome to make a point instead of a question on this occasion if you would like to do so. However, either way, please keep it brief. Sir.
Thanks so much for having this. Will Malden with the Wall Street Journal. I was interested in the division between labor and capital for the income that accrues to the U.S. through the TPP. This is something that came up yesterday with some of the Tufts published economists.
Sorry, I have to clarify a fact. These were not published by Tufts. Go check with Tufts. They did not publish that.
Oh, okay.
That
That's
study.
Good to know. I saw it on their website, but we'll check with it. Anyway, the main point is about labor. My question is about labor and capital. What does that mean? You know, if income accrues to labor, does that mean it goes into your paycheck? And if it accrues to capital, it goes into your 401k? How are we to understand that and explain that to our readers? What does this agreement do compared with other agreements, and how does that reflect on income inequality?
Thank you very much. Carolyn, do you want to give a shot at making that comprehensible?
Unfortunately, I actually haven't read the Tufts study as of yet. There's a nice blog on our website by Robert Lawrence that describes what the CGE model does, which is very well understood by economists. And while it's a black box, it's more like the GPS that's kind of sitting on your dashboard. It gets you where you're going, and it's been perfected over time. We understand the analytics behind it. We understand how trade should affect income through efficiency, largely through efficiency gains. So the pie getting bigger as countries specialize was kind of the old model. The newer models incorporate other types of gains from variety. Because more varieties are available, that leads to big gains for consumers. There's also gains via the extensive margin that weren't in the old models, because now you can export new products There's starting to be gains through shifting within an industry to the more productive firms. So all of these types of efficiency gains are where that income effects are coming from in the standard model. The Tufts model seems to be more of a financial crisis model, from what I can tell. It's not really using a model with different sectors and a production function in those sectors, the intermediates that go into those sectors to create the gains from trade. And so if you use a model where you impose kind of a shock and then you get the world to shrink, something has to be wrong, because there has to at least be some gains going somewhere. According to that model, it seems actually we should all raise protection to get growth started, which clearly isn't the way to go. So does anybody else
Jeff,
want
do you wanna add something?
To add?
Well, very briefly.
Jeff, again. Thank you.
Went off. Very briefly, Will, I strongly recommend you look at Robert Lawrence's blog post, which addresses this issue very, very clearly. Both labor and capital gain. Labor on balance. Not every worker gains, not every company gains. But on balance, workers gain because as resources shift within the economy, they go into more productive enterprises. Workers in those enterprises gain higher salaries. And businesses gain from efficiency gains, lower transaction costs. So you have an increase in both. How that affects income inequality is a much more complicated story.
And it's one that isn't determined by trade policy. It's determined by our domestic politics, unfortunately or fortunately. At the back.
Excuse me. Claude Barfield, AEI. I wonder if you could have a little more discussion on the impact of the very large number, huge, whatever you want to characterize it, of exceptions and reservations. One of the attacks from the free trade side has been that they really vitiate across the agreement the details of the agreement itself. They particularly pointed to the services that Gary talked about as really having undercut any kind of liberalization. So that is the reservations. Did your numbers about services liberalization and the impact include, or did Petrie's numbers include the impact of the reservations? And just talk a little bit more about the impact of reservations across the agreement, particularly services.
Yeah, and maybe Gary and then Kim could do this.
Yeah, that's a great question, Claude. The annexes go into great detail on country exceptions on services, and also the chapters I mentioned, the four chapters, they have their own exceptions. So you're right, there are a lot of exceptions and slow phase out. So how was this modeled? In his original modeling, or their original modeling, Peter Petrie and Michael Plummer assumed that over time about 40% of services non-tariff barriers would be phased out under TPP. But their base measurement of the non-tariff barriers was based on earlier work that some of which we had done at the Institute and others had done, which seriously underestimated the level of barriers to services trade, as reflected in later work done by the OECD and the World Bank and CEPI, which I mentioned. When they looked at the TPP, the modelers said, you know, there are all these exceptions, as you have identified, and we're going to say in our modeling that only about under 30% of them are reduced over time, over the 15 years. And that was by going through and reading and so on. And it's a judgment call. But because the base was higher, that has a bigger effect in terms of the modeling outcome. So that's a rather technical answer to your question, but they wrestled, we wrestled with it a lot, they wrestled with it a lot, and we think that's a fair representation. Now, if you want to come down to actual numbers, we had the Korea-U.S. agreement, thanks to USTR and Jeff and everybody, which has been in effect for a couple of years now. And U.S. services exports to Korea have grown quite sharply, and it's in the numbers. They've grown about, I think, about 60% in just a couple of years. So it doesn't seem fatuous that we're going to get a big growth out of TPP, which basically tries to carry out the same degree of liberalization.
Thank you. Kim, do you want to add anything since you had to look at the miseries of textile non- Anyway, you don't, you
well,
know.
Well, it's not really the exception. So no. I have not looked at all the non-conforming measures, which are legion.
Legion. Thank you. Up front here, please.
Thank you, Adam. Thea Lee with the AFL-CIO. And sometimes I feel like I'm having a little bit of a flashback to the first NAFTA and assessment meeting at the IIE many, many years ago. I think there are some interesting peculiarities in the economic findings, and I'm interested in hearing more from all of you about how you see it. And one of them is one that you mentioned, Caroline, that of the gains to the United States, $131 billion by 2030, only 5% or less than 5% comes from tariff reduction, and the rest is from non-tariff barriers and from FDI. I mean, less than 5% of those gains from tariff reduction seems to me very small, since the tariffs, as you said, are what we talk about all the time in terms of trade agreements, and that really is the trade impact. And when you look at at least the description in the Petrie paper of the non-tariff barrier assumptions, they seem to me a little bit vague. You know, you're taking just, you know, 75% of non-tariff barriers are basically protectionist, and half of those maybe could be reduced, and so on. And so it seems to me a lot of the weight of this study is on something which is fairly amorphous and maybe not that well modeled. And are you saying that, you know, isn't it true that then a lot of the economic gains are from deregulation as opposed to trade from the agreement? So that's one piece. The other thing, I think, in terms of some of the other impacts for other countries, China being a big loser from the agreement, and yet, you know, with the weak rule of origin, particularly in automobiles, couldn't China be a huge beneficiary? Particularly, you mentioned, I think, that China, you know, already does export a lot of auto and auto parts to Vietnam and Malaysia, and it could be that China could be a huge beneficiary. And I actually did want to sort of draw attention to one thing that you said, Caroline, because I think from the point of view of labor and why it is that people in labor see trade agreements differently from corporations, you talked about the weak rule of origin in automobile as allowing over time a reorientation of production in a more efficient structure. We call that outsourcing in the labor movement. We call that a loss of jobs. You know, if you talk about the percent of a Toyota Camry or other car that is made in the United States, we like to see the high percentages. And I think Kim made the point in terms of rule of origin that why do we have a rule of origin? So that the benefits of the agreement go to the signatories. And I think that goes back to Jeff's point, which is that, you know, if this is such a fantastic agreement with such great FTA upgrades in it, then why do we want the benefits of it to go to countries that have not made any commitments to us, whether in terms of market access or investment or services or anything else? So I just was interested in some of the taking apart some of those differences. And also, just one last point, and I'm sorry, I know I'm going on a little bit, but no. I ask your indulgence, but that if the, in terms of the labor capital impact and who the beneficiaries are, so there is a basic finding that labor is a winner from this trade agreement because, I guess it's, you know, because it's going to have more productivity and therefore workers are going to transfer. Because we're assuming full employment, they'll transfer into a higher productivity sector and therefore they will, of course, earn more money. I guess I'm asking all of you, honestly, have you seen from past trade agreements, has this been the historical pattern of how workers' incomes and jobs have been impacted by trade agreements?
Well, thank you, Thea. Very substantive, clear questions. Carolyn, you want to go first, and then people can respond as they please.
Yeah, sure. Those are great questions.
And I want to start with the gains from tariff reduction, the kind of small percentage for the U.S. coming from that. Well, the way that we think of these gains, the economic gains that are going to be had, is from moving resources to the more productive sectors as a country liberalizes. And given the already very low tariffs in the U.S., you actually get very little kick from that because we're pretty efficient in this country. So from a mercantilist perspective of tariff reduction, we might get a big kick because other markets are opening up. But what the model actually is picking up is moving into the more efficient sectors. And our tariffs are already pretty low, so that's not, there's not that much of a reduction in U.S. Protection levels via this agreement. Much more of the tariff reduction is actually coming from our trade partners. With respect to rules of origin, what I'd like to say is, I guess it goes back to the same efficiency view of the world, that you can make the pie a lot bigger by producing all the parts where it's most efficient to produce those. And, I mean, most of us have now seen the picture of a car with parts produced all over the world, made in the world, not made in the U.S. or made in China, but made in the world. And there's a big efficiency gain from making products in the world so that there are more cars at cheaper prices for everyone. And, you know, it goes back to a discussion we had here a week or two ago from our colleague Steve Wiseman's book about, do we care about a job for a citizen of the world, or do we care about a job for an American worker? And if you view it from a reduction of poverty and an increase in global GDP, then I would rather see a world where things are made where they can most efficiently be produced, and all global citizens, or the benefit to global citizens, is far greater than the benefits to protecting workers in very specific sectors in the U.S. And finally, and I apologize on the first question, I got so involved in describing a CGE model, I don't think I ever came to answering the question. Where I do think it's important to think about is there are distribution consequences from tariff, or even in this case, not tariff, but just overall liberalization, where some workers will be hurt in some industries. But I think over and over, case after case, we've seen that protecting specific workers just pulls you further and further back from the frontier. And even our colleagues, Ted Moran and Lindsay Aldensky, the study that Gary mentioned, there's some evidence that as you increase the outsourcing, yeah, specific workers lose, but overall there's a gain because we need more engineers here to design the products that are produced elsewhere. So there are workers that are gonna lose, but it's about retraining. It's about redistribution. That's a problem. It is a real problem. I fully agree. But I'm not convinced that restricting trade, we don't restrict technology, which has much bigger effects in the exact same direction. And yet we wouldn't think of, you know, protecting ourselves from the next device that may reduce the need for some workers. So, you know, I think overall, what we'd like to see is productivity growth, GDP growth, and the world economy getting bigger, and the billions of people being brought out of poverty.
No, if I can just pick up a second on what Carolyn said, and then we can go to that gentleman. I think this isn't just about making excuses or ignoring organized labor's, in some ways, very legitimate frustration. The issue is the U.S. is failing its lower income people across the board. and not about trade. And as Carolyn said, if you look at, say, if you look at Rochester, New York, right? So Kodak went out of business basically because digital photography came along. People said it was Fujifilm or whatever, but no, it was doing all right. It was digital photography put it out of business. And you go to Rochester, New York now, and Rochester, New York is not a terribly pleasant place, and the people who were stuck there have not been well treated. And that's got nothing to do with trade. That's got to do with our failure in this country to look after our own workers. And I think what is important, and I, again, I'm not trying to set up a straw man or say something, put something in your mouth. This is a general issue. What Carolyn, I think, has seized upon, and where she and Brad Jensen and Lee Branstetter and various others outside the Peterson Institute have contributed in the last 10 years, is making the recognition, and it's not a model recognition, it's an empirical, data-driven recognition, that the gains from trade are fundamentally about reallocating workers and capital between firms and industries. They're not about breaking down tariffs. That is the reality, and that grew out of the literature that, again, is empirical, not theoretical, that where you got growth in the U.S., where you got growth in various economies around the world was out of productivity growth and not out of the accumulation of more labor, more capital, more jobs. And so the issue is the adjustment. And when we start talking, that's where there's obviously legitimate questions. And you can talk about, should there be a sacrifice of a particular set of workers for a particular set of adjustments? And you have to balance issues, as Carolyn did. But I do want to point out that the order of magnitude of the adjustments we're talking about here, even though very large to individual communities and individuals, really is small in the context of the U.S. economy. No, the order of gains. 0.5% a year by 2030. That's a lot. If you when we're talking about a growth rate in the U.S. that's descending down below 2% unsustainable, that's a very big number. Moreover, the numbers we're talking about the people being displaced in the Petri and Plummer study are on the order of 50,000 people a year, which is a lot of people until you realize that there are 160 million people employed in the U.S. economy, and the turnover of people, including involuntary disemployment in the U.S., is in the tens of millions a month. And the idea that we should hold up something that is of gain substantially to the vast bulk of people in the country because there are objections to helping that few people is odd on all sides, in my opinion. Please, at the back.
Thank you very much. Melinda St. Louis from Public Citizen. I had some of the similar questions to Thea, but I'll just to follow up on the tariff side, just a question in terms of modeling how, if at all, currency manipulation or devaluation was factored in at all and how that can be factored in, given that obviously in NAFTA, the devaluation of the peso wiped out a lot of the potential gains that were that the Peterson Institute had noted at the time. So given that there are not binding currency disciplines in TPP, how that might be factored in. And then following up, because I don't think we got to the question about the services and the non-tariff barriers, kind of how the, thinking a little bit more, were some of the potential economic losses that come were netted out from deregulation in terms of lower health and safety standards that could potentially happen in some of the countries as part of deregulation, et cetera. So I think in following up, in addition to some of the things that Thea said around the non-tariff barriers and the murkiness about, you know, how legitimate this model is, you know, were some of those other things taken into account? And just finally on the ISDS question, I would just note that I think while this has been included in past agreements, I think part of the reason why there is more concern now with the TPP is that for the United States at least, then our ISDS enforced PACs have been with almost all developing countries. Canada is the only capital exporting country where we have those types of agreements. So the TPP would double U.S. liability. If we're included in TTIP, it would be a massive expansion of the liability of cross-registered corporations that could use this mechanism in the United States. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Maybe Gary and Jeff would like to respond, or Kim, if she's...
Well, on the services, as Claude Barfield noted, there's a lot of detail in the annexes, but I would commend you to read them and then to pull out areas where you think a foreign country, Malaysia, Vietnam, Japan, whatever, has weakened its regulation as a result of the concessions it made. And as I went through all those annexes, I couldn't see any weakening. I mean, what you typically get are regulations which prevent foreign firms from selling at all or from having more than 20% capital in the firm, or maybe having a large big box retail stores, all these kind of things. To me, those regulations do not protect health, safety, environment, or anything else. But, you know, another person reading some of those changes might see some big damages. I do want to emphasize again that the United States did not relax anything to speak of in the services area. So it should have, perhaps, but it didn't. So you can't say that the U.S. is suddenly subject to improper financial practices by some foreign firm or some kind of health product which would otherwise not sell or anything else. So that would be a completely false charge. Now, on ISDS, that could be a very long conversation, but I'll try to keep it quite short. The U.S., if you're talking about additional liability, we have additional liability to Malaysia, Vietnam, and Japan, because those are the countries which we did not have agreements with, which had an ISDS. Pardon? And Australia, right. We did not have one with Australia before. So we have four countries that we have additional liability. Where you see liability, I see, you know, we've got to behave reasonably. And we have behaved reasonably. There have been 13 cases brought. The U.S. hasn't lost any of them. When I read ISDS, I see it as an exportation of U.S. non-discriminatory treatment of firms worldwide. I think other countries are coming to agree with us, and I don't see all this exposure that is talked about. Now, I realize that the opponents of ISDS, they had a big platform that they lost when the tobacco case against Australia was rejected. I've written a little policy brief, a colleague of mine and I have written it, on Keystone, which will be your next platform to argue against it, and we could talk about the merits of that. But all the objections on ISDS, which have been ventilated by Senator Warren and many others, all are in the hypothetical realm of what might happen if. Well, I can argue hypotheticals. What might happen if some federal district judge goes wacko on some issue? That's the legal process. You know, it can happen, but we have corrective mechanisms.
Can I just briefly just add on that? I hesitated to respond to Claude's question because I haven't gone through the, I don't know how many hundred pages of the non-conforming measures, as the exceptions are called, but I went through a few of them just to try and get some flavor, and many of the ones that I looked at, you know, explicitly exempted education and health and other public services from the various commitments on investment and SOEs and so forth. So I think, you know, that for their own political reasons were there are explicit exemptions for many of those things in there. Secondly, on the ISDS, I'm still a bit of a skeptic. I have not been convinced that this is something that's really necessary. But having said that, it does seem to me that the TPP is it's a very far from what the NAFTA ISDS procedure was in terms of putting in safeguards against frivolous lawsuits and other things. And then the third thing I would just say, I know it's controversial, but I think that the that USTR did the right thing by exempting tobacco. It is a special product. It's the only one that, when used as directed, kills you. There's an international control convention. So I don't think it's a slippery slope to have exempted tobacco control regulations from ISDS. And I think that was a very important step forward from the perspective of developing country health.
Thank you. Jeff, do you want to add anything?
Very briefly, on the currency manipulation, I basically disagree with the premise of your comment. But I would refer you to the detailed explanation that Peter Petry has on how currencies adjust over the 15-year period and how that is taken, how that is factored into the model, and as well as the paper in Volume 2 of our study, which will be coming out shortly by Fred Bergson and myself, on the TPP and exchange rates, which discusses the declaration on macroeconomic policy coordination that addresses the exchange rate concerns, perhaps not in a way that's satisfactory to you or to some members of Congress, but is a big step forward from the existing practice. Thank you.
Thank you. Gentleman at the mic.
Yeah, thank you. I'm Timothy A. Wise from the Global Development and Environment Institute at Tufts University, and I came very much to listen to the discussion and only feel compelled to make a comment here to clarify about what seemed at the beginning to be the study that shall not be named, but I'm glad that it was...
No, the study beneath naming, actually, but go ahead.
Well, I think the... Well, let me clarify a couple things about the study and encourage you all to look at it on its own. The first point is, just to clarify, it is very much a study from the Global Development and Environment Institute, published as a working paper at Tufts University. So I'm not sure what the reference is to it not being from Tufts, but it is.
Okay.
I think it could very easily and constructively be viewed as a supplement to the Petry and Plummer study, which ran through a set of modeling exercises using CGE that, as you noted at the beginning, made certain assumptions that excluded certain outcomes, as may well be necessary in that kind of modeling. So what our model did, it didn't pretend to be a trade model, and the comment that Robert Lawrence made that this is not a trade model is exactly right. It never pretended to be. It's a macroeconomic model. It took directly the Peterson, the Petry and Plummer outcomes on trade, the export changes, and modeled what those would mean if you use different assumptions on employment and income distribution, and didn't assume a priori that that all displaced workers would be absorbed in growing sectors. It is a, as you said, there are reasons people would want to know that, and a model can't do everything. So I would really urge you to think about this as an addition to, not just somehow a competitor to what is being done done here by the Peterson Institute and our colleagues, Mr. Petry and Mr. Plummer. I don't think it is anything of the sort. The substantive question I would ask, though, and just put on the table about the content, is that people do really care about the employment impacts of trade agreements, and they're not wrong to do so. Trade agreements have not worked out tremendously well. There's a lot of debate about how you measure that and what you would measure as displacement and the absorption of workers. I think Thea Lee's comment earlier reflects that there's good reason that people aren't happy about that. And certainly the comment that not all employment adjustments are trade related is absolutely true. There's a much larger set of problems going on, and no one's trying to blame trade agreements for all of those problems. What I would say, though, and really urge everyone to think hard about, is that a 0.5% GDP gain in 15 years is truly, truly small. I mean, we find when we apply different measures, different assumptions, that it's a similarly small decrease. I don't think the importance in that case is that it's a decrease, and you find and Petrie and Plummer find an increase. It's that they're really small changes, and I think it's been pretty well documented just how small those changes are. You're talking about what, on the order of 0.03% additional growth per year. It's not large. So if there are additional costs, if employment is one of those costs, that's what I think we really need to be discussing. And the critics who are worried about the TPP, I think, see studies that dismiss those possible outcomes as not helpful to the debate. So we're trying to supplement that debate. Thank you.
Thank you for clarifying that. And I had been told that the president of Tufts had made some statement about the study. I'm glad to have your correction on the record. In terms of the substance, let me just make two quick points, or three. First is, there's a reason why people look at trade models to look at trade and macro models to look at macro. And the reason is, trade generally has its effects over a 10 to 20 year period, and macro is about a recession or a boom at any given time over a 3 to 5 year horizon. And it is not a dismissal or an ignoring of reality or a distortion of reality to suggest the empirical fact that over a 20 to 30 year horizon, the extent of employment in an economy is generally nothing to do with the amount of trade it does or does not engage in. The composition of that employment, the productivity of that employment is affected, but over a 10, 20, 30 year horizon, there is no support for the idea that trade has an impact on employment. And that's why we do it that way. And that's why the profession does it that way. And that doesn't say that maybe if you say wanted to make the argument that, maybe we shouldn't do a trade deal in the midst of a recession. And that goes to some of these issues of currency manipulation that, as my colleague Joe Gagnon and Fred Bergson have spoken about, the loss of jobs implied by currency manipulation is related to whether or not the U.S. economy is at full employment when it occurs, and whether or not the world economy is expanding when it occurs. That's when currency manipulation has an effect. If the world is already at full employment, which at the moment, sadly, it's not, might not be. But then you have to counteract that against the idea that maybe a trade deal is stimulative to growth in some ways. The final point I would make, again, picking up a bit on Caroline, is there are legitimate and deep issues about the moral ethics of who gets which adjustment, who adjusts and on what basis and what we owe those people and what the rest of us get. And you're absolutely right, and I appreciate your saying that, you know, on the one hand, you don't blame trade. No one, I don't mean you personally, one does not blame trade for all adjustment, but that does not remove the moral content of the adjustment for the people affected. I completely agree with your making that point. I think that is entirely legitimate. However, it is also legitimate, and here's where I pick up on Caroline, to say, okay, let's say that the Petrie-Plummer estimates are the upper bound of the impact on U.S. income. I actually sincerely think that's wrong because, as Jeff mentioned, we have seen serious study after serious study showing that the productivity gains from trade liberalization actually are larger than these kinds of estimates. But, okay, let's say Petrie and Plummer are right, or that the effect is somewhere bounded between the study you have published and the Petrie-Plummer study. And yet, it is potentially completely transformative for the people of Vietnam, Malaysia, Peru, Chile, Mexico, who then have a chance to say, I can cut out of poverty through trade. I can have a relationship with the United States based on economics instead of military factors. I can be part of the global growth, and my people can have the chance to get ahead and add their innovation and their ideas to the world. And so, I do not agree to the idea that this is not of benefit to the U.S., but even if we were to say it is net zero, the idea that you are a possibility of having that transformative effect on the rest of the world and what that means for U.S. foreign policy and the organization of the world and the freedom that's out there would make it a no-brainer win, in my view. I realize there's one more question. If you can, we are a little over time. If you can make it concise, please. Thank you.
Okay. I'm Kim Frankina from GAO. And my question actually just has to do with taking the most advantage of all the work and analysis that's coming out now. How can we have a good debate on TPP that focuses on the real, you know, knotty questions in the coming months? Do you have suggestions for what we really need to think about as we're, you know, considering it in Congress and implementing the bill?
Jeff, why don't you get the last word?
Kim, start with what Adam just said before. I think that's a very important point that sometimes gets overlooked in the debate over very narrowly focused sector or constituent interests. Of course, members of Congress will have to focus and should focus on their constituent interests and make sure that they are properly addressed. But we have a national interest as well. And what we are providing here is both the overall benefits for the United States, both commercial and strategic and foreign policy, as well as sector-by-sector discussions. Remember, this is just volume one of our analysis. We will have very detailed discussions and balanced and analytical discussions of intellectual property, of environment, of labor provisions, of competition policy. Michael Gadbois here contributed to that, on a number of other issues. And I think all of those, which will be out in the next couple of weeks, will help with the narrow specific interests that members have. And that's why we did it, as a reader's guide, to help educate the debate and allow for the type of differences of views to be aired and weighed in that debate in the halls of Congress as well as the halls of the Peterson Institute.
Beautiful, Jeff. Thank you. Thank you to all our speakers and to all our authors and contributors. Thank you to all of you who sat through a long and at times emotionally charged, but I'd like to think, substantive and constructive discussion. Thank you in particular to the gentleman from Tufts who clarified where I was mistaken, and I appreciate your doing that on the record. Just to repeat what Jeff said, this is a major effort from the Institute. We will have our second volume of assessments on the 21st century issues in a sense that we didn't get to today, including labor standards, intellectual property rights, and so on, with a similar stellar cast of fellows under the guidance of Jeff and Kathleen. And we look forward to seeing you all again then. Thank you very much.